What I'm going to do now is to look at the, in a sense, and I hope I don't discourage you, I will be looking at the non-mathematical part of these mathematical expeditions. And I will be also doing and analyzing jointly the two British expeditions, one which headed for Prince, a very tiny island on the Gulf of Guinea, which was part of the Portuguese colonial empire in 1919, and which is now part of the Republic of São Tomé e Príncipe, and the other expedition headed towards Sobral, which was quite a relatively big city of a big state of Ceará in the northeastern part of Brazil. It had around 35,000 people. And so the two British expeditions really headed towards very different geographical and geopolitical settings. To Príncipe went the astrophysics from Cambridge Observatory, Arthur Stanley Eddington, together with a clockmaker expert called Edwin Cottingham, and to Sobral, headed two expert astronomers from Greenwich Observatory, Charles Davidson and Andrew Crommelin. They all, these two teams, wanted to test one of the predictions of Einstein's theory of relativity, general relativity, which had been announced in 1915 and published in 1916. And this, in this prediction was dealt with the bending of light rays as they passed close to large gravitational masses. The organization of these two expeditions, rather than one as usual, took place, as we all know, during the difficult times of the First World War, and when Albert Einstein was not yet famous, relativity theory was not yet generally accepted by the British scientific elite, which was particularly fond of ether theory. So it was not just the physical makeup of relativity which was counterintuitive to most experts and at odds with the concepts of Newtonian classical physics, but also its mathematical apparatus grounded on the theory of invariance and the calculus of variations were also very difficult to understand, not only for experts, but for lay people alike. And this was precisely the gist of the opening address delivered by J.J. Thompson on the 6th of November 1919 at the joint meeting of the Royal Society of London and the Royal Astronomical Society of London, in which he certainly presented the first step towards the acceptance of general relativity as provided by the results of these two expeditions, but he could predict, and very well so, that the process of acceptance was going to be a long and arduous one. And this has been the topic of a book which recently came out by the historian of science Matthew Stanley called Einstein War, precisely because of this. The difficulties in accepting the results of the expeditions had also to do with the scrutiny of the work on data reduction, which took place throughout the summer and the autumn of 1919, and which was mostly done by Eddington on one side and by the astronomer Royal Frank Dyson, who you can see in this picture, on the other hand. In fact, Frank Dyson was aware of the importance of the expeditions and was behind the organization of the expeditions for 2 years then. I mean, since the first communication he delivered at the Royal Astronomical Society on the 9th of March of 1917, he called attention to the importance of the eclipse of 1919. And he was so much involved in this organization that he pushed forward the organization of two expeditions instead of one in order to double their probability of success. And this because there had been already two former expeditions organized, one in 1912 also in Brazil, the other one in 1914 when the war began in Crimea, and they had been unsuccessful. So he was really up to using these expeditions to test Einstein's prediction. The expeditions and what the astronomers wanted to observe and wanted to photograph was very different from the usual aims of turn-of-the-century astronomical observations. In fact, the reason why this eclipse was so important was that, first of all, it was a very long eclipse. It lasted 5 minutes, in fact, 302 seconds. And also, the question was that behind the Sun, there were a group of stars, the constellation of Taurus, and behind the Sun. So the background of stars was very rich of stars and very brilliant ones. And this was particularly important because what these astronomers had to measure was really, they had to photograph not really the Sun, but the background of stars. And what they had to do was to take pictures of the stars, the image of stars during the eclipse, as you can see on the left hand side of this slide, and then they had to wait more or less a month to take what it was called a comparison photograph at a time in which the Sun was not anymore in between the stars and the observer, and so the light emitted by the stars was not deflective if there was deflection. Okay, and then they had to compare to compare the two sets of pictures to see if there was deviation or not, and if there was deviation, if this deviation was followed Einstein's prediction, which was quite a minute prediction of 1.75 seconds of arc. And this value was in fact the double of the value which could be accounted for by classical physics if one accepted in the framework of classical physics a corpuscular constitution for light. And this is the front page of the paper, which was jointly authored by Dyson, by Eddington, and by Davidson, which came out right a couple of months after the public announcement in the early January 1920, in which they, it's a very long paper in which all details of the two expeditions, the setups, the results, the observations, and the calculus of deviations is explained thoroughly. And what you can see in this front page is precisely this idea that there is going to be a contrast between Einstein's and Newton's theory. If we know that Eddington was a very special astronomer, quite knowledgeable of physics and mathematics, and so favorable to the theory of relativity. This is not the case with Dyson. So he supported the expeditions. He understood very well that it was an opportunity not to be missed by British astronomers. And he says so in this first communication I already mentioned, which was then published in the Observatory concerning on 9 March of 1917. Why was then Dyson so interested in this test? Because this physical theory, which he probably did not really understand, or he was not really sensitive with, had explained out of the blue the advance of perihelion of Mercury. So for an astronomer and for British astronomy, this could be quite an important step to do. He also mentions on the 9th of March 1917 that there is going to be another eclipse before the 1919 eclipse. This eclipse took place, happened on the 8th of June 1918 in central United States, but he really dismissed the involvement of British of a British team, given the adverse political and astronomical conditions. So, contrary to Eddington, who, as he said in a book he published a few months after the joint paper called Space, Time and Gravitation, I was not altogether unbiased towards Einstein's theory. Dyson was neutral towards relativity as a physical theory, but sensitive to its astronomical consequences. And so, despite their degree of allegiance being very different, they both worked towards the reduction of data and, in fact, towards the announcement on the 6th of November. It is especially after the 1970s that doubts about the rigor of observations of the date and of data analysis that were put forward both by physicists and by philosophers of science. Criticisms encompassed accusations of elimination of data that favored Newton's theory based on Eddington's early advocacy of Einstein's theory. But, of course, inclination towards a theory is not equivalent to data manipulation. And one should, in fact, mention that in the manuscripts held at the Cambridge Library, the most important decisions concerning the elimination of plates were done by Dyson upon noticing that at Sobral, the main telescope with the astrographic lens lost focus during the eclipse because of heating of the Kelostat mirror. And this has been, in fact, the work done by historian of science Daniel Kenefick for almost a decade now, in which he has been addressing the question of scientific malpractice and has been discussing thoroughly the steps taken by British astronomers, arguing in their favour and against contemporary accusations. His detailed analysis also came out very recently in a book fittingly titled No Shadow of a Doubt. So, as to my argument, the British expeditions were certainly mathematical in a very great variety of ways. I've briefly addressed most relevant in order to show that mathematics was dominant at both ends of the spectrum. I mean, as an integral part of Einstein's prediction of light bending, which the expedition set out to verify, but also as a vital component of the process of data analysis, which proved Einstein right. So, the use of mathematics was instrumental to the expedition's success. But mathematics was always irrevocably intertwined with astronomy and with physics, and we saw this already in the preceding talks. In this talk, then, I want to change the focus of analysis from the astronomical, physical, and mathematical pillars of Einstein's prediction and the expedition's impact in proving general relativity right, which have been already amply discussed in the literature. I opt instead, first, for a joint discussion of the two expeditions, which has not been done so far. They have been discussed separately. And I want to show that their scientific consequences, physical, mathematical, and astronomical, were grounded on a number of people, events, and decisions, which are often bypassed in standard narratives, and which are essential, although often invisible, to the success of the scientific enterprise. In order to do this, I have been using printed sources, as usual, scientific communications, discussions and publications, but also private sources. And among these private sources, the letters, the correspondence which Eddington sent both to his mother and sister, but also the extended correspondence with the observatory, Astronomical Observatory of Lisbon, are extremely important on, for once, to get us a sense of the views, the feelings of the astronomers throughout their travels, and on the other hand, to give us also a sense of how the communities of astronomers and other people of the countries in which the observations took place, basically Portugal and Brazil, how they reacted to these events and how they were central pieces in this whole narrative. So, taking into account the geographical, the very different geographical and geopolitical asymmetries of the two selected sites of observation, a big city in a quite big state of a country, which was independent from Portugal for already almost one century, and a tiny island, part of the Portuguese colonial empire. But despite its really despite being so small, it was one of the biggest cocoa producers at the time. And in fact, there had been a conflict which took place basically 10 decades before the expeditions involving the Portuguese and the British government concerning the accusations of forced labor in the cocoa plantations. And also, we should keep in mind that one of the more important buyers of cocoa from Prince was precisely the Cadbury family and the Cadbury Company. And so there is also here a religious connection. Quakers are behind all this story, not only because Eddington was a Quaker, but because the Cadburys were also so. But this is a part of the story which I cannot go into details in what follows. So, having in mind this very different situation, both geographical and geopolitical, I'll focus on three sorts of invisibilities. One has to do with the published accounts by expeditioners and is associated with the active role of local people, especially during the observation of totality. The second one has to do with the inexistence of photographs of the experimental apparatus and of the travelers in Prinsp, in sharp contrast with what happened in Sobral. And finally, and this is how this comparative exercise will go, and also then it's a sort of eraser of the reference of Portugal as a colonial power, which I think has to do, of course, with this difficult situation and this difficult conflict opposing the two countries. So let's go to the section I call to be or not to be, observing totality. Here you see a small part of a triptych which was shown in the exhibition in Lisbon concerning the travel of the two British teams. And in this triptych in which we detailed what went on since the time they left Greenwich to the time they arrived in Sobral and Prinsp and then back to Liverpool and Great Britain, you can see in this map that in these 302 seconds of totality converged already 2 years of preparations done in wartime, that were subject to weather tricks. Both in Sobral and in Prinsp, the weather did not behave as expected, mostly in Prinsp, but also in Sobral, as we saw, the astrographic got some problems. Then, despite the financial support of the British government, no equipment was acquired, and the accuracy of the measurements depended on instruments adapted from pre-existing parts held in various British observatories, and converging in the Royal Greenwich Observatory for the final preparations in early 1919. Then the astronomers moved around 2 tons of material for regions which were quite distant from the point of departure, 7,200 kilometers to Sobral, 5,800 kilometers to Princeton. Finally, the success of these expeditions depended on the participation of astronomers from the countries where the observations took place, that is, from Portugal and Brazil, but also depended on the availability and willingness to participate of members of the local elites and also of workers who helped in the preparations and who became forever anonymous. So it's obvious that if we are able to have private records of these expeditions, we'll really be able to get a very a close glimpse at what happened during the observation, during the trips, and also during the observation of totality. And what I am going to do with you next is to compare precisely how Eddington described the expedition in a letter to his mother, which was sent on the 21st of June, when he was already sailing back to Britain, and then compare how he describes the moments of totality in the joint paper published in the beginning of 1920, and then in the non-technical book, The Popularization of Science book, Space, Time and Gravitation, published a few months later. And I'm sorry, but this is the... I'm sorry in the sense that I will be reading quite an extended part of the letter to his mother. In fact, it is a very long letter, and the discussion of totality starts on the last line on the left-hand side. And as it's difficult for you to read due to the transparency of the pieces of paper, I have here the transcription, and this is the one of the pages of the graphic novel, I mean the basis of one of the pages of the graphic novel, which basically illustrates that there were not just two observers, but in fact nine people in total. And the first paragraph precisely starts mentioning who was present. Mr. Carneiro, he was the owner of the plantation Sundi, where the two observers were living and where they did the observations, the curador. This was the man in charge of imported labor, of all the workers that came from African mainland in Angola and Guinea and came to work in the plantations sometimes forever. The judge, Mr. Wright, who was one of the two British black men who were working at the cable station, and the only person with whom Eddington and Cottingham could speak in English. So we know that on the morning of the eclipse, Carneiro, the curador, the judge, Mr. Wright, three doctors came over. Just as they arrived, a tremendous rainstorm came on, the heaviest we have seen. It was most unusual at the time of the year, but it was favorable for the eclipse as it helped to clear the sky. The rain stopped about noon, the eclipse was at 2:15, greenish time. There were a few gleams of sunshine after the rain, but it soon clouded over again. About 1:30, when the partial phase was well advanced, we began to get glimpses of the sun. At 1:55, we could see the crescent through cloud almost continuously, and there were large patches of clear sky appearing. We had to carry out our program of photographs in faith. I did not see the eclipse, being too busy changing plates, except for one glance to make sure it had begun, and another halfway through to see how much cloud there was. We took 16 photographs, of which 4 are not yet developed. They are all good pictures of the sun, showing a very remarkable prominence. But the cloud has interfered very much with the star image, what they really wanted to get at. The first 10 photographs show practically no stars. The last 6 show a few images, which I hope will give us what we need. But it is really disappointing. Everything shows that our arrangements were quite satisfactory, and with a little clearer weather, we should have got splendid results. 10 minutes after the eclipse, the sky was beautifully clear, but it soon clouded over again. In fact, I was in Príncipe this last May. It was raining and cloud, and I have in my mobile phone the weather since May, and it's always raining, always clouds. So it was really a difficult time for them. We developed the photographs two each night for 6 nights after the eclipse, and I spent the whole day measuring. The cloudy weather upset my plans, and I had to treat the measures in a different way from what I had intended. Consequently, I have not been able to make any preliminary announcements of the result, but one good plate that I measured gave a result agreeing with Einstein, and I think I've got a little confirmation from a second plate. So, from the letter to his mother, not only we get very precious details on who was with the observers observing totality, but we have a first assessment of the works done by the team, and we also, in the last sentence, we have Eddington's scientific inclination put out very bluntly. This is, of course, not the case in the paragraph which Eddington wrote in the 1920 paper. And if we read this paragraph, we see that he does mention very precisely the beginning and the end of the eclipse. He mentions also the details of the observations, of the number of plates used, but he doesn't mention any emotions. There are no feelings of the observer. I mean, he mentions the notability of the prominence, but the disappointment caused by bad weather, the faith in believing in the program's execution, or finally the hope that the result prove Einstein's prediction is totally absent. And to proceed with this exercise, let's go then to the chapter called Waiting Light in Space-Time and Gravitation, an outline of general relativity, which is basically a theoretical outline. And so in this chapter, Waiting Light, Eddington excuses himself to come into the details of the expedition. And in this chapter, it describes the moments of totality in the following way. Our shadow box takes up all our attention. There is a marvelous spectacle above, and as the photographs afterwards revealed, a wonderful prominence flame is poised 100,000 miles above the surface of the sun. We have no time to snatch a glance at it again. We are conscious only of the weird half-light of the landscape and the hush of nature, broken by the calls of the observers and the beat of the metronome ticking out the 302 seconds of totality. So, what we can see is that in the terms of the content of the written accounts, there is a decreasing gradation of emotions from the richness of the private communication, which exposes the astronomer's feelings, to the popularization of science book, which describes with emotion landscape and the environment, but omits the observer's impressions, and finally to the dryness, the factual, detailed and technical information contained in the scientific paper. We also know from the letter who was really present during the eclipse. And if we have in mind, now that we know that more than two people were present in the eclipse, we might want to look at this phrase, broken by the calls of the observers, and the suspicion arise. We don't know if these observers was Eddington or Cottingham, or if one of the other people who had observed the eclipse were really helping them with metronome. I'm saying this because this was precisely what happened in Sobral. For Sobral, we don't have, unfortunately, any private correspondence, but Crommelin wrote a very short article in the observatory called The Eclipse Expedition to Sobral, in which we have a glimpse of the feelings of the astronomers when they were traveling in Amazonia, waiting for the time of the eclipse to come. And if we compare, so there is a detailed description also of the bad weather condition and what they did during the time of totality. And then there is, in the end of this short article, a reference to an expert from the Ministry of Agriculture called Leocádio Araújo, who was helping the British astronomers all along, for the reason that he was a knowledgeable person, but he also knew English, and this was always the problem they had. And if we compare what Crommelin said in this paper with what he said in the joint paper, we can see that when the crescent disappeared, the word go was called and the metronome was started by Dr. Leocádio, who called out every 10th beat during totality, and the exposure times were recorded in terms of these beats. So we really understand that both from these two accounts that Leocádio Araújo was present helping the metronome, which secured the exact times for the change of plates and the correct exposure times. And this is why I think that having this in mind and comparing these two sorts of sources, we might suspect that that observer in Prince was really someone else. We don't know, and we won't be able to know, I guess, unless other sources arise, I don't know. But the following nights, both in Sobral and in Prince, the work of revelation of the plates took place. And very interesting, we know from their reports that in Sobral they had to use typical local clay pots to secure adequate water temperature, and the developing plates were then dipped in containers with the solution guaranteeing proper conditions. In Prince, as well as in Sobral, they also relied on local aid, and this was ice supplied by Mr. Grajeira, the manager of the Colonial Agricultural Society. And again, these ice and these clay pots were important for securing correct temperature conditions, and this is why also the revelation took place usually during the night. So, coming to a conclusion of this first comparison, what we can see is that expeditions not only brought with them instruments built with pre-existing instruments, components adapted to wartime conditions, but daily objects added in loco were temporarily promoted to auxiliary scientific instruments. So these expeditions, despite the minuteness of the detail they wanted to observe, were not really high-tech technology. They were very low-tech, and in the observation of totality, accuracy of measurements was the result of what we call technologies of use, or what David Edgerton called technologies of use and household items. So, different. If we cross out these different kinds of sources, it becomes clear that both in the plantation Sundi and in Sobral, expeditioners observed totality in the company of other participants, some of whom held prominent functions. That is, despite their invisibility, two types of local actors participated directly in the experiments, both in Sobral and in Prince. The workers who provided manpower to transport the equipment, to build supports for the instruments, or the protective structures of the whole apparatus, and also the members of the local elite who participated in the observations of totality or offered the materials, clay pots or ice, necessary for the success of revelation of plates. Finally, these local actors were joined by national or colonial astronomers, authorities or individuals that helped them along the way. And so, let me, after this first invisibility, let me really come towards the phase of my talk, which I talk which I called to depict or not to depict when visual records matter, and which has to do with a very, again, a very asymmetrical record. There are lots of pictures for, there are lots of pictures for Sobral, and there are none for Príncipe. One of the pictures we have for Sobral was taken by Davidson. It's the picture of the setup, the tent, the two telescopes and the two mirrors. In fact, the picture I have below, it's a picture taken and part of a very nice album gathered by the American magnetic observers. So it's the back of the tent, but we have many other group pictures of the astronomers together with other people, whom I will show in very shortly. But the contrast with what happened in Príncipe is really stark. There are no pictures whatsoever. And this also has to do, of course, of the different geographical situation, geopolitical situation of the two places. And this also is the reason why there were three teams observing in Sobral, the Brazilian, the American, and the British. And there were just two observers of one team, the British team, observing in Príncipe. Because there are no pictures for Príncipe, it was very hard work to arrive at this three pictures. Working together with an architect who has been looking at the architecture of the plantation Sundi, we came to realize that the main house in which the astronomers were housed looks like this. Okay, and I think that the place where the instruments were set up, which in fact is done by coordinates in the joint paper, but this gives some uncertainty to it, has been finally, after 100 years, spotted correctly. And it's represented here. This is an installation, a painting by a local artist, which marks the right place where astronomers made the observations. And having in mind that the material for the two British expeditions was prepared in times of war at the same time, I think that it's very, very safe to say that the tents were the same, and that in Príncipe we had just one astrographic. We didn't have the small telescope which was lent by the Jesuit astronomer Corti and the accompanying small mirror. So I think that 100 years after the eclipse, we have quite a considerable depiction, a depiction of what went on in Príncipe. But let's get back to Sobral. What sort of pictures do we have? We have pictures, group pictures of the Brazilian team with the American and the British team members. And it's very easy. I'm sorry, it was not this one. I want to spot here. Here you have the director of the Observatory of Rio de Janeiro, then the National Observatory, this very tall guy, Henrique Moritz, French origin. This is Davidson and Crommelin. This is one of the magnetic observers, and the other one is this one. So the foreigners are wearing white suits or light colored suits, and then there's a quite a substantial group of the Brazilian team, which in fact included 17 people. We have here again a group picture, which is also very interesting because we can see that the Brazilian members have brought their families. In fact, Maurice celebrated his anniversary while in Sobral. His wife was from the state of Ceará, and you have also some kids, and I'm showing you some more. But basically, what we can see is that the record we have, the photographic record we have, is has been provided by Henrique Moritz, by the director of the National Observatory of Rio de Janeiro. He was the director since 1908. He was also, since 1916, the president of the Brazilian Academy of Sciences, which had been founded 3 years before this, and which was also part of a strategy of the Brazilian scientists of showing to their countrymen, and especially to their government, importance of science, and in this case of astronomy. And so that there were lots of activities and events going on because the centenary of the independence of Brazil was approaching. This took place in 1922. So it's very clear that for Moritz it was really important to first receive the expeditioners, and in that sense, as it happened in Portugal, since 1917, he was absolutely clear that the 1919 eclipse should be observed in Brazil. So he contacted the British astronomers. He also in previous expeditions, notably one which took Davidson and Eddington to Brazil in 1912, he also, as was common practice among astronomers, received the foreign teams and provided all the logistic conditions for the observations to take place properly, although he could not control weather, and so in 1912 they could not observe much. And concerning the 1919 eclipse, he secured the support of the Brazilian government, but also of local, not only civil, but ecclesiastical authorities, in order to receive properly and in a sense with pomp and circumstance the British team who observed in Sobral. Moritz arrived in Sobral on the May 9th, and the Brazilian team was interested in astrophysical observations, but in fact they provided all the necessary requirements for the British team to observe in perfect conditions. So what we can see from this profuse record of visual record is that it reflects the importance for Moritz and for the scientific Brazilian scientific community to affirm a scientific research ethos, to affirm the importance of science for Brazilian society, irrespective of its practical applications. This was very important for them. And also the importance of consolidating a cohesive and autonomous scientific community. The importance awarded by Moritz to this visual record was such that besides this visual record, we can also have a glimpse of the many, many newspaper coverage which happened in Brazilian newspapers. I have just started to unveil this amazing group of information, and again, it's also very interesting. There are basically no newspaper articles in Portugal, not in not in the colonies, nor in big mainland papers, newspapers in Portugal. And there is an ample coverage. You can see many of them here. Not only newspapers of the state of Pará, where they arrived and from where they departed, but also of the state of Ceará, where they made the observations in Sobral. And through this news, in fact, Einstein theories was presented to Amazonia. this is the first introduction of Einstein in Amazonian lands. There are also many newspapers in Rio de Janeiro, then the country's capital, and so we can see that in the same move, Einstein was projected to the Brazilian public, but also Brazilian astronomy was projected into the public sphere, helping in the process its recognition and visibility. And so, let me then proceed to my last invisibility, which pertains to the different way in which Brazil and Portugal are mentioned in the written records of the two expeditions. In most cases, Portugal is never mentioned. I mean, what is really mentioned is Príncipe. Príncipe is presented, and very well so, as a small island in the Gulf of Guinea, in the west coast of Africa. And I think that probably the reason why, with few exceptions, and when the exception is this one, which I shouldn't have shown you at this point, with few exceptions, Príncipe is detached from its status of a colonial island. And I think that this might have been a way to obliterate the undesirable political connections associated with the accusations of forced labor. So there are two exceptions. The two exceptions is the introductory communication by Dyson on the 9th of March of 1917, in which he introduces Príncipe Island, a small developed Portuguese island which became celebrated a short time ago owing to the politicians' interest in slave cocoa. In the 1920 paper, there is a difference. Príncipe is a small island belonging to Portugal, situated just north of the equator in the Gulf of Guinea, about 100 miles from the African coast. So it's Portuguese, but there's no mention of the conflict opposing in the past, in the very recent past, the British and the Portuguese. It's also interesting that the different treatments concerning Brazilian authorities and Portuguese authorities is very clear from the acknowledgements in the last part of the 1920 paper. The support of the Brazilian government is widely recognized, as you can see. In fact, it's also mentioned the support by Moritz, the director of the Rio de Janeiro Observatory, acting on behalf of the Brazilian government. But as to the Príncipe expedition, there is just the mention and the thanks to Jerónimo Carneiro, the plantation owner, and the Atalaya, who was his manager, and whom we know from the letters written by Eddington to his mother and sister, that they entertained long conversations in very rudimentary French. So Atalaya became quite a close friend of Eddington. While the director and the deputy director of the Observatory of Lisbon were extremely important for the success of these expeditions, they are not mentioned in the end. They are mentioned in the part pertaining to Príncipe. And in fact, they, the National Observatory of Lisbon, they also worked on their own behalf, but on behalf of the Portuguese government. And what I want to show you in what follows is the a bunch of letters which were written to Eddington, to the director of the Lisbon Observatory, and then the correspondence continued with Om, the deputy director. The director was 80-something at the time, and so he delegated into his deputy director. And what we can see from these letters is the close connection and the importance of these astronomers for the success of the two British expeditions. The first letter written by Eddington, interestingly, is written on the 11th of November 1918, which is the day of the armistice was signed. This first paragraph basically introduces Eddington and Cottingham and says that they are going to observe one of the results of Einstein. The letter goes on. He asks information as to accommodations in Prinsp. In fact, on the travel from Liverpool to Prinsp, he puts Om in charge of the connection with the colonial institutions in order to secure for them travel and accommodation. He asks also for interpreters, and by the end of this lecture, he sends the regards of Dyson. And this is really interesting because Dyson had been in Portugal back in the 20th to observe the total eclipse of 28 May 1900. And so Dyson sends his regards to Om. He remembers Om because Om had developed a consistent strategy of receiving the foreign observers, both professional and amateur. This was, of course, a move by Om, by the deputy director, not only of proving to the foreign astronomers that Portuguese astronomy was equivalent in terms of standing to other countries, but also it was a part of a strategy developed by Om in the sense of gathering the support of the Portuguese government for Portuguese astronomy. So in both Portugal and Brazil, and in many other countries, of course, local astronomers, local communities of astronomers use the scientific occasions provided by Eclipse to assert a specific scientific agenda vis-à-vis their governments. There is a very interesting letter, which is written by Eddington to Om on May 4th. As you can read, and you can read it very easily, he basically says that they arrived in the island on April 23rd in a steamship called Portugal. We are being most kindly entertained by Mr. Carneiro and have everything we could possibly desire. Everyone has received us most kindly and has given us every assistance. And in typical optimism, Eddington's optimism, he says all we need now is a fine day for the eclipse, something they didn't get, of course. This is a beautiful island, and besides making good progress with our work, we are thoroughly enjoying our experiences with many things, so on and so forth. The last letter is written on his way when he's already back in Britain on the 3rd of August. It's a very short and last letter thanking the support of the Portuguese astronomers. We arrived home on July 14th after a pleasant voyage. I think you may be interested to have the enclosed paper enlargements from three of our negatives. They do not show all the fine details of the original, but the prominence is very remarkable. With many thanks to you and Dr. Om for your great kindness and help to us. The first and last letter is addressed, of course, to the director of the observatory. And in fact, it's here, by going over the correspondence of Eddington held at the archives of the Lisbon Observatory, we were able to find these paper enlargements, which were lost somewhere. And it was following this research that we managed to get the three paper enlargements, which are here, and the one in the middle, which is very well known and shows the very spectacular solar prominence. So, to conclude, In fact, I wanted to mention a little bit slave cocoa, but I will skip it. And these are two pages of the graphic novel in which this is taken from an overview of the plantation Sundi. And here you can see the senzalas, which were the workers' apartments, very, very tiny. And here, and here are all the anonymous people we don't know of and which really were crucial for the success of this enterprise. So, I hope to have shown that the joint assessment of both expeditions raises pertinent historical questions, some of which I have addressed in this talk. Their answers, some still conjectural, cross science, astronomy, physics and mathematics with technology. They cross geography and colonial empires. They cross politics and religion. This is something I didn't mention very much in this talk. They show also how networks of scientists, local elites, anonymous actors, and general public were all fundamental to their preparation, execution, and final success. They also illustrate how narratives told about them create asymmetrical accounts, giving prominence to certain actors, institutions, and places at the expense of obliterating others. They reveal how these expeditions were much more than mathematical. They were the result of a peculiar combination of mathematics with physics, astronomy, material conditions, societal constraints, political decisions, and religious factors, which jointly converged to their success. In sum, it is my contention that the joint assessment of both expeditions enables to move from past histories towards a global history of the 1919 eclipse. Thank you.
Can you say, you mentioned that Sir Arthur Eddington told his mother that mm-hmm. he thought he had fulfilled Einstein's predictions, but nothing was mentioned after that. Who actually said something in public or in a paper about whether Einstein had been vindicated?
Okay, thank you for your question. In the public presentation on 6th of November, the decision was taken. I mean, the final result was very bluntly discussed. And although they were announcing the result in the main hall of the Royal Society of London under the picture of Newton, in fact, they announced that the results, in a sense, proved Einstein right. There were, of course, lots of discussion going on afterwards. I mean, it's because not everybody was convinced, and especially people did not really understand what was going on and what was this theory about. But in this communication, then in the joint paper, and also in the popularization book, Eddington really makes his position clear. And then because there were lots of photographic plates which had been eliminated, then started all this discussion concerning if this expedition really proved Einstein right, because many of the plates had to be discarded due to the bad weather in Prince, but also in Sobral. All the plates taken by the small, by the big astrographic had were basically discarded. So the evidence was rather slim. And so in 1902, there was another eclipse and people proceeded in trying to substantiate the result of this expedition.
What are your thoughts about the letter, the contents of the letter to his mother? Do you think that's normal? And did it, his other letters to his mother, did it, are they the same detail?
Okay, the letters which are held at concerning at the Trinity College concerning Eddington's correspondence, mostly to his mother, are usually very detailed, not only in the daily routine of the astronomer, which is also very interesting, of course, but also concerning specific scientific details. For example, from one of the letters that he writes when he is in Brazil in 1912, we can understand that probably in Rio de Janeiro he met another German astronomer, and it was in 1912 that probably he heard for the first time of general relativity, which was not there yet. I mean, he heard that Einstein was trying to extend his special theory. So it's very interesting that they go from lots of daily details. For example, the 1919 correspondence is very interesting because he's always talking about the fact that he eats lots of meat, he eats lots of butter, lots of cakes. I mean, rationing is not there any longer. So he also describes all the amazing fruits that there are in Prince, but he comes on always recalling that he hopes to be back home for the strawberries, which are really the fruit he really enjoys. But then, at bits and pieces, he gives lots of very detailed information and scientific information.